Subcommittee on Investigations and Oversight will come to order. Good afternoon. Welcome to today's hearing titled The Federal Perspective on a National Critical Materials Strategy. Chairman Brown is unable to attend due to a family emergency, so I am sitting in for him today. You will find in front of you packets containing our witness panels, written testimony, biographies, and truth and testimony disclosure. I recognize myself for 5 minutes for an opening statement. The subject of today's hearing is one which this subcommittee is very familiar with. A little over a year ago, under the then Democratic majority, the Investigations and Oversight Subcommittee held a hearing on rare earth minerals. Rare earths, as most of you know, possess unique physical and chemical properties that make them particularly suitable for use in advanced technologies such as high-powered magnets, petroleum refining catalysts, batteries, and lasers, among others. They are also important components in everyday items that everyone in this room probably has right now, such as cell phones and Blackberries. This committee did some very good work last year, as we heard from industry folks, academics, and scientists. Today we follow up on that work and take the next step in this process by hearing from government officials. I am pleased to welcome our distinguished guests. While they represent different agencies within the administration, they are here today because of their collaboration on an interagency working group on critical and strategic material supply chains. Critical materials include rare earth elements, which are more widely recognized today than they were when this committee last addressed this topic. That the issue is still of interest to Congress is evident by the number and variety of bills introduced in both the House and the Senate. I myself recently introduced H.R. 2090, the Energy Critical Elements Advancement Act, and Mr. Miller from the Democratic side has a bill also. In 1980, the National Materials and Minerals Policy Research and Development Act was enacted because the United States lacked a coherent national materials policy and a coordinated program to assure the availability of materials critical for our national economic well-being, national defense, and industrial production, including interstate commerce and foreign trade. 31 years later, this committee is presented with similar issues, and to quote Yogi Berra, is deja vu all over again. Our witnesses today will provide us with some insight into the administration's perspective on critical materials. Dr. Holdren will discuss the activities of the interagency working group that was created last year. Mr. Sandalow and Mr. Doebrich will discuss their respective agencies' involvement in the group, as well as provide us with an overview of their agency's responsibilities relative to the topic of this hearing. Taking it a step further, I look forward to some honest conversations about appropriate roles that should and shouldn't be played by the federal government. While I appreciate the need for federal research, I believe we should distinguish between basic and applied research, recognizing that the government may have a role to play in the former, but that it should not duplicate nor preempt work that is rightfully done by industries. For about two decades, the price of rare earths and critical materials were low, perhaps artificially so, because of Chinese policies. As a result of these policies and our own stringent rules regarding environmental standards, U.S. suppliers were unable to compete. Now that the Chinese have restricted exports, prices have gone up because non-Chinese suppliers have all but vanished. These policies have led to various international trade protests that remain unresolved. Conversely, there are those who say that we shouldn't fret over these conditions because the financial markets will ultimately correct the situation. The expansion of Lynas Corporation in Australia and the growth of Molycorp in the United States provide hope that alternatives to Chinese rare earths will be available shortly. In the interim, though, we still need a plan, one that should assess issues such as stockpiling, permitting, researching and development, workforce development, recycling, information gathering, and manufacturing and production incentives. I look forward to exploring these options and hearing from our government witnesses today. The chair now recognizes Ms. Edwards for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you in advance to our witnesses today. I want to thank the chairman for taking up this important issue, and I also want to acknowledge the work of the former chairman of the subcommittee, Mr. Miller, who held the first hearing on this matter for the committee, and who also worked with his then vice chair, Kathy Dahlkemper of Pennsylvania, to craft legislation designed to help address the shortage of rare earth elements. Rare earths are just one class of materials that are crucial to our economy and our national security. This committee has a 30-year-long history of trying to establish an ongoing institutionalized focus on potential shortages of such materials. But at different times, both Republican and Democratic administrations have let this matter slip off the table. That said, I congratulate the Obama administration for grasping the challenge of critical materials and organizing to develop a coherent set of policies. I'm very pleased to see Dr. Holdren here today to talk about those efforts. The public focus on shortages is largely on rare earth elements, but tomorrow the challenge may indeed be scarce isotopes or metals or minerals. I think we need to recognize that government should have an ongoing capacity to work to identify potential shortages and adopt policies designed to avoid or diminish the disruptions that come with shortages. Some argue that the rare earth element story will end up validating the power of markets to address demand. It's true that there are aggressive efforts underway in Malaysia, the United States, and other places to develop rare earth extraction capacity. However, even if those efforts prove fruitful, the reality is that China's aggressive use of access to their rare earth reserves will have succeeded in moving manufacturing facilities and jobs to China. Once there, those facilities are highly unlikely to move away. Further, there is nothing to keep China from reversing its rare earth policies if they face competitors. At the moment, China has cut export quotas to create incentives for firms to move there and to capture exorbitant profits from those reserves they do export. There's nothing to stop the Chinese government from reversing course in the future and flooding markets with rare earths to drive their competition out of business. And when faced with a state-controlled economy the size of China's, we cannot assume that markets alone can solve our problems. I want to warn that those who blame our loss of mining and rare earths on environmental regulations, that they are overlooking the reality that the key lever the Chinese used to win a virtual global monopoly in mining in the first place was cutthroat pricing. That said, rare earth mining and processing has proven to be a very dirty business in the past with pollution, including radioactive waste, a trademark of this industry. I expect that our work to develop a domestic industry will not ignore the real dangers inherent in earth mining and process, and that we will see Molycorp and others set a global standard for environmental compliance and safety. I look forward to the testimony today and hope that this marks the beginning of an ongoing dialogue about how to protect our jobs, our economy, and our national security for unfair trade practices and resource scarcities. I'd like to yield my remaining time to my distinguished colleague, Mr. Miller of North Carolina.
Thank you, Ms. Edwards. Ensuring reliable and stable supply of energy critical elements is obviously vital to our national security and our economic interest, and this has been an issue of interest to me for some time. As both Ms. Edwards and Mr. Holdren have said, I chaired a subcommittee hearing on this a year ago. As a result of that hearing, this subcommittee did develop legislation. Our Democratic staff did great work. Ms. Dalkemper, who was in the vice chair of the committee, introduced the legislation, and I have introduced that very similar legislation again that is based upon the work of the subcommittee last year. But that really was not the first legislation of this kind. We are not new to this issue. We recognize the importance of critical materials in the 80s and passed a National Materials Minerals Policy, Research and Development Act. I say we, meaning Congress, but obviously I was not here then. But executive branch efforts really have been non-existent for almost 2 decades now. It is time that we do start focusing on the issue. We cannot allow ourselves to lose the competitive advantage that we have had in the past or have those materials, access to those materials used to leverage other economic advantages. And I look forward to working with the Office of Science and Technology Policy, the Department of Energy, and I'm glad that they are paying attention to this issue as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Edwards and Mr. Miller. If there are members who wish to submit additional opening statements, your statements will be added to the record at this point. At this time, I would like to introduce our panel of witnesses. First, Dr. John Holdren, Director of the Office of Science and Technology Policy. Next, Mr. David Sandalow is the Assistant Secretary for Policy and International Affairs at the U.S. Department of Energy. And Mr. Jeff Doebrich is the Acting Program Coordinator for the Mineral Resources Program at the U.S. Geological Survey. Thank you all for being here. As our witnesses should know, spoken testimony is limited to 5 minutes each, after which the members of the committee will have 5 minutes each to ask questions. Your written testimony will be included in the record of the hearing. It's a practice of the Subcommittee on Investigations and Oversight to receive testimony under oath. Do any of you have any objection to taking an oath? Let the record reflect that all witnesses were willing to take an oath. You will also be represented by counsel. Do any of you have counsel here with you today? Okay. Let the record reflect that none of the witnesses have counsel. If all of you would now please stand and raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Let the record reflect that all the witnesses participating have taken the oath. Thank you very much. You may be seated. I now recognize our first witness, Dr. Holdren. Thank you.
Well, Chairman Hultgren, Ranking Member Edwards, members of the subcommittee, I want to start by thanking you for the opportunity to testify today on administration policies and interagency efforts for addressing the issues that surround the production and use of critical materials. There is, as you have already mentioned, a number of you, a long history of concerns about the availability of critical materials, which we call that because their supply is highly concentrated in either one country or in a few corporate entities, or because they are used in the production of goods that are important economically or for national security. The Executive Office of the President in this administration has been focused on this issue for well over a year, since March 2010, in fact. The Office of Science and Technology Policy, in close coordination with the National Economic Council, the U.S. Trade Representative, and the National Security Council, has been convening, as you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, an interagency working group to develop the necessary understanding of the critical material situation and to focus administration thinking and resources on risk mitigation. 4 points have emerged from that process as key to understanding the overall situation. The first one is that concentrated production does not necessarily mean the reserves are equally concentrated. China currently accounts for about 95% of world production of the rare earth elements, but is host to only a third to a half of the known reserves. In situations of that kind, market forces will work over the long term to mitigate risks as other suppliers come into the market to take advantage of higher prices and new demand. Second point is that market size does not necessarily predict disruptive potential. For example, the U.S. market for raw oxide forms of rare earths is small. It's only about $170 million a year, or about 0.001% of U.S. GDP. But these rare earths serve as vital ingredients in many advanced technologies in the commercial and defense domains, including the emerging clean energy sector, which are worth much more. Third, the risks of supply disruptions depend on what form of the material is deemed critical: raw minerals, metals, alloys, components, or finished goods. For any given material, a detailed analysis of the entire supply chain is necessary in order to identify where the vulnerabilities are and to identify effective mitigation measures. Fourth, in the short term, the administration can use trade relations and diplomacy to foster the diversification of supply of critical materials, as well as taking steps to facilitate domestic production. In the long term, the greatest opportunities to reduce the risks associated with critical materials are through investments in research and innovation. In the rest of my time, I want to elaborate on some agency and interagency activities that are currently underway and contemplated to address those issues. First of all, it's important to identify proactively and continuously which materials are critical based on an agreed-upon set of criteria. A number of departments, agencies, and outside entities, including the National Academy of Sciences, have been and are conducting such analyses and developing frameworks that will ultimately allow us to anticipate material shortfalls before they actually happen in the market. Second, given the growing interdependence among countries supplying and using these resources, a shared and accurate understanding of global raw material flows, location of resources, and material demand is essential. The OSTP convened interagency process is investigating the best ways to accomplish that. Third, USTR is closely examining China's policies, restricting exports of raw materials, including rare earths, and continues to press China to remove those restrictions, both through bilateral dialogues and through international venues. Fourth, and for the longer term, the administration proposes to initiate additional research activity on critical materials issues. The President's FY 2012 budget includes $20 million for a DOE innovation hub in that domain, and I suspect that Assistant Secretary Sandalow will describe that hub and other relevant DOE R&D activities in more detail. In closing, let me emphasize that the Obama administration is taking the topic of critical materials and their supply chains very seriously indeed. Federal agency efforts are being coordinated through the White House-led interagency process, as I mentioned. We remain in close communication with the scientific, technical, and business communities, and certainly we look forward to working with this subcommittee, with the full committee, and with other members of Congress to improve our national capabilities in this domain. I'll be happy to try to answer any questions you have. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Holdren. Thank you for being here. I now recognize our next witness, Mr. Sandalow. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Edwards, and members of the subcommittee. I join Director Holdren in thanking you for holding a hearing on this important topic today. Earlier this year, I visited the Mountain Pass Mine in Southern California. I was impressed by the facility and its potential to provide a domestic source of rare earth metals. According to the facility's owners, the mine will produce at an annual rate of about 19,000 tons of rare earths by the end of 2012 and 40,000 rare earths by the tons of rare earths by the end of 2014. And doing that using modern technologies at a globally competitive cost. Now that's an important step in the right direction. The issue of critical materials is important and needs priority attention in the months and years ahead. At the Department of Energy, we share the goal of establishing a stable, sustainable, and domestic supply of critical minerals, and we look forward to working with the Congress on this issue as we move forward. Members of the committee, the world is on a cusp of a clean energy revolution. Here in the U.S., we're making historic investments in clean energy. The American Recovery Act was the largest one-time investment in clean energy in our nation's history. At DOE, we're investing $35 billion in Recovery Act funds in electric vehicles, batteries, and advanced energy storage, a smarter and more reliable electric grid, wind and solar technologies, among many other areas. Now, other countries are also seizing this opportunity. For example, the Chinese government is launching a program to deploy electric cars in over 25 major cities while building huge wind farms, ultra-supercritical advanced coal plants, ultra-high-voltage long-distance transmission lines, and more. India has launched an ambitious national solar mission. And in Europe, strong public policies are driving sustained investments in clean energy. In recognition of the importance of certain materials in the transition to clean energy, DOE is working to address the use of critical materials in clean energy components and products and processes. As a first step, last year we released a critical material strategy, the first of its kind ever released by the Department of Energy. The report found that four clean energy technologies, wind turbines, electric vehicles, photovoltaic cells, and fluorescent lighting, use materials at risk of supply disruptions in the next 5 years. In the report, five rare earth elements, dysprosium, neodymium, terbium, europium, and yttrium, as well as indium, were assessed as the most critical in the short term. For this purpose, criticality was a measure that combined the importance of the clean energy economy and the risk of supply disruption. Our critical material strategy highlighted three pillars to address the challenges associated with these materials in the clean energy economy. First, substitutes must be developed. Second, recycling, reuse, and more efficient use can significantly lower global demand for newly extracted materials. And finally, diversified global supply chains are essential. That means encouraging other nations to expedite alternative supplies and exploring other potential sources of materials, in addition to facilitating environmentally sound extraction and processing right here in the United States, because domestic production is the most secure. With all three of these approaches, we must consider all stages of the supply chain, from sound material extraction to purification and processing to manufacture of chemicals and components and ultimately to end uses. This year, DOE is updating our analysis. We have, in recent months, sent out to the public a request for information and in the process received back over 500 pages of information from over 30 respondents with a variety of information on multiple topics. One lesson we've learned through this experience is that supply constraints aren't static. As a society, we have dealt with these types of issues before, mainly through smart policy and R&D investments that reinforced efficient market mechanisms. We can and will do so again. We must be smart and serious as we plan for a growing global demand for products that contain critical minerals. With focused attention, working together, we can meet these challenges. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sandalow. I now recognize our final witness, Mr. Doebrich.
Good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today to discuss the role of the USGS in informing decisions regarding a national critical minerals strategy. The USGS is responsible for conducting research and collecting data on a wide variety of non-fuel mineral resources. We conduct research to understand the geologic processes that concentrated known mineral resources at specific localities in the Earth's crust, and to estimate quantities, qualities, and areas of mineral resources. We collect, analyze, and disseminate data and information on current production and consumption for about 100 mineral commodities, both domestically and internationally. We also conduct research on the interactions of mineral resources with the environment, both natural and as a result of resource extraction, to better predict the degree of impact the resource development may have on human and ecosystem health. This full spectrum of mineral resource science allows for a comprehensive understanding of the complete life cycle of mineral resources and materials: resource formation, discovery, production, consumption, use, recycling, and reuse, and allows for an understanding of environmental issues of concern throughout the life cycle. Global demand for critical mineral commodities is on the rise, with increasing applications in consumer products, computers, automobiles, aircraft, and other advanced technology products. The USGS has recently completed an inventory of known domestic rare earth reserves and resources. This study reviews current U.S. consumption and imports of rare earths, current knowledge of domestic resources, and possibilities for future domestic production. The report also includes an overview of known global rare earth resources and discusses the reliability of alternative foreign sources. Though rare earth elements are currently of most concern to many, including the Department of Defense, which funded this inventory, it should be noted that in 2010, the United States was 100% dependent on foreign suppliers for 18 mineral commodities and more than 50% dependent on foreign sources for 43 mineral commodities. Import partners include Brazil, Canada, China, France, Germany, Japan, Mexico, Russia, Venezuela, and many others. The USGS is a member of the OST-convened interagency process on critical and strategic mineral supply chains. USGS information on domestic and global mineral production and consumption and expertise in understanding this information are being provided to the interagency group to help inform decision-making and to support the ongoing activities that relate to a national critical minerals strategy. In particular, the USGS is taking a lead role with other interagency members in the recently established sub-working group to identify high-priority critical materials and to establish the methodology and criteria necessary to make those determinations. This work will enable the federal government to anticipate material shortfalls before they happen. And will be a more core competent in establishing a national critical mineral strategy. The USGS stands ready to fulfill its role as a federal provider of unbiased research on known mineral resources, assessment on undiscovered mineral resources, and information on domestic and global production and consumption of mineral resources for use in global critical mineral supply chain analysis. Thank you for the opportunity to explain the role of the USGS on this very important topic, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
I thank the panel for their testimony. reminding members of the committee that committee rules limit questioning to 5 minutes. The chair will at this point open the round of questions. The chair recognizes himself for 5 minutes. First question, Dr. Holdren, wonder if you could help me with this. Just some understanding on the interagency working group. The interagency working group has met over the for the last year now. Wondered, will it produce any deliverables? And then also wondered if you can comment on any proposed legislation that may complement or duplicate the efforts of the working group.
Sure. I would actually argue that the working group has already produced some deliverables. It will certainly produce more, but its meetings have been working sessions where the agencies under the direction of the Executive Office of the President are actually doing things and committing to do additional things. Examples include the studies that have already been mentioned by my fellow witnesses, the reports that have come out of the DOE and the USGS, World Trade Organization litigation from the USTR, the new R&D programs out of DOE, proactive engagement with industry by the Department of Commerce and the Office of the Trade Representative, over a dozen high-level bilateral meetings between the Department of State and foreign counterparts on these issues. And so we have already been actually generating products, doing things, taking action. Your question about the legislation, as you know, there are a number of bills, Mr. Chairman, including one of yours. We have not taken a formal position as an administration on the specific characteristics of these different bills, but there's a lot in them, and again, I would point to yours in particular, that we're clearly very much in agreement with. Your bill calls particularly for three focuses. One is on better information, one is on recycling, and one is on research. We agree with all of that, and we are already pursuing all of those avenues. I would say the additional approaches which we regard as important and clearly warranted are diversification through discussion and encouragement not only with companies in this country but companies located among our friends and allies. And also, really, I would add negotiation, which includes discussions with China in both bilateral and multilateral forums to try to make clear to China that it's actually not in China's interest to restrict trade in these materials.
Changing course a little bit, Dr. Holdren, but again, asking you a couple questions here, if I may. Just specifically, according to press reports, the DOD sees that there is really no rare earth crisis right now. I wondered if you concur with the DOD's observation. And then following up on that, what's your assessment of the rare earth and critical material situation in the U.S. relative to non-defense applications? And should the U.S. be engaged in stockpiling critical materials for non-defense applications?
Just jotting notes so I can remember all three parts of your question. First of all, the DOD assessment, we are actually still awaiting a formal and comprehensive assessment from the Department of Defense, which is due out next month. Earlier statements, I think, were perhaps incomplete, but I think the basis for them was probably that the quantities required by the Department of Defense are relatively small compared to the quantities required in the commercial sector. And I think the department's assumption is probably that given those small quantities and given the very small fraction they represent of the cost of the systems to which they're important, the department is assuming it would continue to be able to get what it needs, even if at higher cost, without a significant impact on the overall cost of the weapon systems and the programs. But again, I don't want to preempt the appearance of their actual comprehensive study on this, which is due next month. Your second question was on the overall situation with respect to these materials in the commercial sector. And certainly, they're very important. The value added by the use of these materials, even though, as I say, the price of the materials themselves is a relatively modest share of our GDP, the value added is much larger, and their importance to emerging sectors, such as particularly the clean energy sector that Assistant Secretary Sandalow was talking about, is very great. So we really have to be focused on our capacity to maintain access to these materials over time. When the National Academy conducted its study that came out just 3 years ago on minerals, critical materials, and the U.S. economy, they developed actually a methodology for defining and quantifying how critical is critical. And they looked actually at 11 minerals and mineral families, and among those, the rare earths were the most critical, exceeded only by platinum and rhodium. If you look at the methodology and you look at the results, criticality in terms of importance and in terms of the risk associated with our supply of those materials. That's pretty strong stuff, that among all the minerals we import, and again, my colleague from the USGS talked about the fact that we're 100% dependent for our supply of 18 minerals and over 50% dependent for our supply of 43. Out of all of those dependencies, rare earths are right up there at the top in terms of criticality. One can talk about some very specific ones. Europium, which has no substitute in red phosphors that are used in our LCD screens and color cathode ray tubes. That stuff's now going for around $2,000 a kilogram, and again, there's no substitute. Erbium, there's no substitute for erbium in its special properties for use in fiber optic cables. It's going for about $1,000 a kilogram. Other materials, cerium, has unique attributes that are used in lens and glass polishing, for example, mirror polishing for telescopes. It's much cheaper than the others, but it has such unique attributes that one has to consider it critical. A whole set of them, of the rare earths, neodymium and several others, samarium, gadolinium, and more, are essential in permanent magnets, in memory sticks, in DVDs. So when you ask for what is the situation in the United States, very important stuff. A lot of it is critical. We've got to be paying attention. Your last question was about stockpiles. I think stockpiles have a very checkered history. The government investing in stockpiles can be a pipeline by which taxpayer money bids up the price and gets the private industry out of the business of having their own stockpiles. I certainly would have serious reservations about the government investing in stockpiles. The private sector does have some incentive for stockpiling. It does do some, and that's one of the reasons that our short-term situation is perhaps not as serious as the percentage dependencies would indicate.
Thank you. I now recognize Ms. Edwards.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the witnesses. Dr. Holdren, over the last 30 years, we've seen the government's commitment to addressing critical materials, both in the executive branch and in the Congress, wax and wane as different specific crises have emerged and receded. And I think one of the key things that we need in place is a structure that's going to remain in place even after you and I've left our current positions to ensure our government is better able to anticipate supply problems with critical materials in the future. And so I wonder if you have any specific recommendations on how to accomplish that. And I wonder if you could tell me whether you think administration policy, either this administration or past administration, actually contribute to the lack of industry development. And I would note the closing of the Ames Information Center in the early part of the last decade, and the shift at the same time of the industry pretty much to zero. And so I wonder if you could comment on that, Dr. Holdren, and then I'll turn to you, Mr. Sandalow.
I have to admit, Ranking Member Edwards, that I'm not an authority on the history of this industry. It is my impression that the decline of the industry in the United States and the transfer of the production, so much of the production of these materials to China, was, as you mentioned in your opening statement, largely a matter of economics. The Chinese simply underbid everybody else. They did it in part, I think, by neglecting environmental impacts of the mining of these materials, which are often severe. They are now coming around to recognizing that and starting to try to rectify it. I'm very much encouraged myself, looking forward, by Molycorp's announcements about new technology that they have developed that will enable production in the United States to be both more efficient and much cleaner than production was in the last round. I think this has substantial potential for restoring our own productive capacity. But I don't think it was particularly U.S. policies that caused the decline in this country. Again, I think it was the Chinese underbidding.
Well, let me just turn to Mr. Sandalow, because in your statement, you mentioned, one, your visit to Mountain Pass and the importance of what you were seeing there, but at the same time, Molycorp has had a bit of a difficulty in securing a loan guarantee, for example, from the department. And so that is about administration policy, because how do you begin to stand up an industry that then can thrive on its own and have the capacity to produce in a competitive market when we're not, I mean, we can't provide, obviously, the level of support that China can provide, because you can do that when you just got a government that says we're just going to spend here and we're not going to spend anywhere else. And where we also have a regulatory structure in place that I think is actually really important to protecting the public health and the public interest. So, you know, Mr. Sandalow, can you just tell me if you've given any thoughts to what steps need to be taken to protect our domestic capacity to mine and sell critical materials in the face of the price pressure from the likes of a China?
Thank you for the question, Ranking Member Edwards. And there's no question we need a wide range of policy tools in order to be able to develop this industry going forward. The Department of Energy's Loan Guarantee Authority today does not extend to mining operations. And so there are limits in the ability of the department in this respect. But what we identified in our strategy was a three-pronged approach. And that includes areas that are particularly in the competence of the U.S. Department of Energy. For us, research and development is particularly central. The Department of Energy is the nation's leading funder of the physical sciences. And so research and development into substitutes is particularly important. Research and development into more efficient use and reuse is particularly important. And then developing a globalized supply chain, including domestic supply, is important as well.
Dr. Holdren, because you also have mentioned, obviously, our need to develop a more robust manufacturing capacity. We could talk about that across all kinds of lines, but it does seem to me that our manufacturing capacity, a 21st century manufacturing capacity, is actually tied to our ability to produce the domestic supplies that we need without being held to whatever quotas might be imposed from those who, in fact, are investing in mining of critical materials.
I can only agree with that, Ranking Member Edwards, and I think the whole domain of advanced manufacturing is immensely important. The President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology recently completed a study in that vein. The President has been out there talking about what we need to do to lift our game in advanced manufacturing and restore some real strength to the manufacturing sector in this country, and I agree with you that attending to these matters of critical minerals is going to be an important part of that strategy.
Thank you. I now recognize Dr. Bashan for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This, again, seems to be another area where our country is dependent on foreign nations for sources of minerals, oil, whatever you want to call it, and it's quite distressing, actually. And I think that this is a great hearing to have, because we do need a strategy to reverse that, just as we do with our dependence on foreign oil. The basic question I have is pretty simple. What are the one or two things that we need to do in our country to decrease our dependence on China for these type of minerals going forward? It's pretty simple. I can start with Dr. Holdren, and then everyone can comment.
Well, Congressman Bashan, I would just say again that recycling and diversification are two of the most important things we can do early, and diversification includes both the development of sources domestically and the development of sources in friends and allies, Australia, Canada, countries on which we can really rely, not to cut us off. Recycling also has very substantial potential, and we need to emphasize it. But over the longer run, research to develop substitutes is going to be crucial.
Well, I would, Congressman, thank you for your question, and I'd echo the thoughtful comments of Director Holdren, and just say as well, this is an area that government and business can work together and work together well, and that a partnership between government and business institutions can only make a difference for our country. I think it's a place where government can do the initial research, some of the R&D can help to create the knowledge base, and then working together, we're all headed in the same direction, I think. This is one where we can really come together to help solve a problem.
Yes, and Congressman, with regards to supply risk that we're facing with regards to rare earth, I think diversifying supply, understanding where potential future supply may be able to come from, and that's the role USGS can help with in terms of assessments for undiscovered rare earth resources, both domestically and internationally.
I guess the last time when we lost our domestic production was based on economic factors primarily. That's what I'm hearing. What prevents economic factors, competitive factors, to just keep our companies out of business again in the future? For example, if, as some people are saying in their testimony, China just floods the market.
Well, I would say, first of all, that the strength of America, American companies, American manufacturing has always been innovation. And we have to, as the President has said, out-innovate our competition. And I think it's going to be innovation that enables us to compete. We've already heard about some of the innovations that Moly Corp itself has pursued and achieved. And I think what one finds is, over the long run, the strategy of flooding the market with cheap stuff to drive out your competitors doesn't work very well. I think China would pay a very high price for doing that. But we can't, as some other comments have suggested, rely on good sense from that quarter, and therefore we have to take the steps and make the investments we need to make sure that on our own we can do what is necessary and together with our friends and allies to diversify those sources.
Mr. Sandalow, any comments on that?
I think that's very well said.
I yield back. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. I now recognize Mr. Miller for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Holdren or Mr. Sandalow, in the past, the rare earths research was carried on at the Rare Earth Information Center at the Ames Laboratory, and DOE is now proposing an energy innovation hub on critical materials. What are the advantages of using a hub or a center to carry out the research?
Thank you for the question, Congressman. This is a model that the DOE is using now and brings together some of the best minds in a single place to focus on a challenge of a special national importance. And that's a goal with something like a hub. And with concentrated funding, with funding that will sustain itself over a number of years, bringing together the best minds and creating synergies between different disciplines, we think we can make progress. And this is just a perfect area for doing something exactly like that. I would say the Ames National Lab, which you point to, has been a historic leader in this area. It's been a leader for, you know, since World War II with extraordinary expertise. And so we want to build on that at the Department of Energy with substantially augmenting what they've already done with substantial new capabilities.
Okay. Is it more or less cost-effective to do the research in a hub or a center?
Yes, it is more cost-effective and more productive. More productive to bring different disciplines together and in one place, creating synergies and complementarities.
Okay. Again, to any of the panelists, do you think we have the researchers now in the United States who have the skills and the knowledge to carry out the critical materials research that we need done, either in the private sector or in government?
Yeah. We, in my view, Congressman, we do not. We need concentrated effort in this country to build up the intellectual capital, not just the industrial base in this country, you know, in this area. That means know, training chemists with, you know, experts in lanthanide chemistry and a broad range of other disciplines who can make sure that we are innovating in a way that will transform this industry and make a difference for the future.
If I may just add to this, I think candor does require that we confess that there are some real financial challenges in this whole domain. You've raised the question, really the question of our science and technology education and training in this country, and we know we have to lift our game in that domain. We have to train more scientists and more engineers, and we train those at every level, from our community colleges to our great research universities. And we have some real funding challenges in that domain. As you know, the President proposed shortly after he came into office that we should be aiming to double the investments in our basic science, our most important basic science agencies, the NSF, the DOE, Office of Science, and the NIST laboratories. And that money radiates out into the research universities. And it's going to be a real challenge to do that in the current budget environment. The President has been clear he wants to do it. But obviously, we're going to need the help of the Congress to pull that off. And I will say this because my colleague from the USGS might not want to, the budget of the USGS is an important issue here. The capacity of the USGS to deliver the analysis and the information that we need to identify the most critical areas, to identify the shortfalls potentially before they materialize, it requires that you maintain those capabilities at the USGS, and the current USGS budget makes it a great stretch to do that.
Okay. Dr. Holdren, you said that R&D reduces the risk associated with critical material shortages. I think I know what you mean by that and how that works, but could you elaborate on that some?
Sure. One of the things that R&D, particularly in material science, leads to is substitutes. You know, we used to think we were going to rely on copper for all our communication circuits. Now we rely very heavily on fiber optic cables. That's a result of research that enabled us to do that. Research will unquestionably lead to better ways, in many cases less expensive ways, to achieve some of the tasks for which we now depend on materials that we have to import.
Okay. I yield back my time. That was
my... Thank you. I now recognize Dr. Beneschek for 5 minutes.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, for coming. It's a pleasure listening to your testimony. Mr. Holdren, I have a question for you concerning your previous answer. How are you going to convince China it's not in their interest to control the market on these materials? Because I don't see how we can do that nicely.
I'm not sure we can do it nicely, but there are a couple dimensions. First of all, they might believe it's in their interest to control the market, but if we out-innovate them, they won't be able to. If their only strategy is to try to drive out the competition by flooding the market with very inexpensive material, they're going to lose their shirts.
Well, they've done that, and they're making money.
They've done it from time to time in the past, but I think going forward, if we apply our comparative advantage in innovation, it's going to be harder for them to do it going forward.
But how's that?
They
control the market now, so how are you going to do that?
20 years ago, they didn't control the market. We did. And again, they captured it by underbidding everybody for the time. But their capacity to do that indefinitely is limited because we will out-innovate them.
How is that? How do we out-innovate them? We don't have the material.
Oh, we do have the material. The United States has very substantial reserves.
So, okay, all right, good.
Material.
How do we get that material to market here in this country faster?
I think we've been talking about how we do that here. We encourage U.S. corporations to make the investments. We help them with
research. My information here is that it takes 7 to 10 years to get a permit for some of these mines.
The question of permitting is one that I would defer to colleagues.
That's a critical issue here.
Permits, but let me simply say about that. I'm not sure where the 7 to 10 years comes from. I suspect that part of that is hesitation and delay over whether one can compete economically and not actually the inability.
Well, this is the inability to get a permit. People are willing to do it. They just
well, no, permit. I hear you, Congressman. I'm just not, I have not looked at these analyses of how it takes 10 years. I think if it is taking 10 years, that's problematic and we should fix it.
All right. Thank you. Mr. Doebrich, what could the administration do as far as you're concerned about, making it easier for us to develop these resources here at home, other than talking the Chinese out of, controlling the market?
From a scientific standpoint, just providing better information, understand what our resources are, where they are, how much there is. I think also beyond the United States, there are known and potentially future supplies as well outside of China. And I think that's an important point to make as well. With those who are perhaps a little bit friendlier trading partners.
Well, I think part of the problem myself, and I'm in hearing of you address this, was the fact that the uncertainty in the permitting process, the uncertainty in the regulations that they're going to change from one year to the next, as far as the requirements for the EPA and all that sort of thing. Do you think that's had any effect on the ability to raise money and market these big projects?
Again, from a scientific standpoint, I can't comment on that.
Dr. Holdren, do you have any comment on that?
Well, I did see a statement the other day that Senator Bingaman offered in which he made the argument that profitability and not permitting had been the real obstacle, and it's profitability that we have to work on. But I'm prepared to agree with you that we need to simplify the permitting as well. And I would note that this administration, this president, has issued an executive order on simplifying regulatory regimes, and a lot of progress has been made on that, and more will be made, because we understand that unpredictability in regulation is an obstacle to investment in business, and we want to improve that situation. We're taking steps to do it.
Could you provide this committee with some examples of that streamlining process?
Absolutely. I'll submit that for the record.
Thank you.
Happy to do that.
With that, I yield back.
Thank you, Dr. Banaschak. I now recognize Mr. McNerney for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Doebrich, I'd like to get an idea of how much of environmental damage was done at the Mountain Pass mine before it was closed. Is that a significant amount of damage, or is it not that significant?
So I don't have specifics on that, but I can perhaps look into that and provide some information for the record.
Mr. Sandalow, do you have an idea on that?
Congressman, I don't know the detailed history. I did tour the site, and I did see the environmental management techniques that they're applying right now, which certainly from a tour looked very impressive.
So you have confidence in Molycorp's claims? You think they're reliable? You think they'll be as good as their word on that?
Well, I hope so, Congressman.
So do we all do. What I'm wondering is, Can economic drivers alone, the high cost of water, the high cost of power, can those considerations alone encourage American mining and reprocessing operations to clean up and do a good job, or are we going to need some other guidelines to help make sure that that happens?
Again, from the Department of Interior standpoint, I mean, that would be a question perhaps to the BLM. I have to defer to them on that.
I guess I would add a comment on that. I wouldn't say that market forces alone will lead to all the kinds of environmental controls that one would want. But we do have in place a very substantial number of laws passed by the Congress that affect air and water quality and the protection of land. And my assumption is we will continue to enforce those laws, and that those, together with economic incentives to become more efficient and cleaner, will push us in the right direction.
And that Molycorp should be able to compete economically with China, with the China producers within a few years. Is that their estimate? Is that your estimate?
They are saying they can. I would bet on it.
And yeah, I heard that personally as well, and to just broaden the point, there's no market that American innovators can't compete in and win, and this is one of them.
Good. Thank you. What I want to know is, do you feel, Mr. Sandalow, that the real risk with the current imbalance, trade imbalance on this issue, is that China will force industries and jobs to China that won't return? Is that the real underlying risk that we're looking at here?
That's a concern, to be sure, Congressman. I think there are other concerns as well. All of these concerns can be addressed if we're smart and serious about the way that we do this with R&D on substitutes, on efficiency, and on globalizing supply chains.
Well, I mean, I hear that I hear you saying that if we do recycling, which means people using their cell phone batteries when they die and that kind of stuff, will produce a significant quantity of these materials. And also innovation, what are the potentials there for the recycling part of this?
I'll take recycling on. The potential for recycling depends on a number of factors. It depends on the value of the material. It depends on how expensive the processing is for getting that material out of the products it's in. It depends on the logistics of how concentrated the sources of products are that you are going to process to get the stuff out. And I would say the answer is that recycling looks good for some of these materials and less good for others. Recycling is also not going to be adequate in situations where a market is very rapidly expanding, because the stuff that you're recycling from is not as large in quantity as what you need for the expanding sector. And so, for example, if you look at permanent magnets for the wind turbine market, where wind turbines are growing very, very rapidly, recycling is not going to do that for us. I think we have to be realistic, and we have to discriminate between different circumstances. Some where recycling will help a lot, others where it won't, and we have to rely on other kinds of measures, including diversification.
Is there a sort of a unified or coordinated program to put research money in areas where substitution would be a good alternative, Mr. Sandalow?
Yeah, this is something that we're investing money in at the Department of Energy, in our energy efficiency renewable energy program in particular. And it's something we're looking at. We're talking to colleagues around the government about as well.
So you're trying to avoid duplication, or?
Absolutely, Congressman. Yeah.
Thank you. I yield back.
I recognize Ms. Adams for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Dr. Holder, and I listened to the back and forth with you and Mr. Benishek, and I have a question. If you haven't researched all the factors, how can you make that assertion that China would not flood the market?
I don't have a clear crystal ball, Congresswoman, and so I can't assert that China would not. I can only assert that there would be some disadvantages to China in doing that. I would also point out that we are engaged with China in the World Trade Organization, that China has a considerable economic interest in maintaining good trade relations with the United States and other countries, and so there is some leverage there.
You know, nonetheless, a lot of our debt.
They do. That also means it's not particularly in their interest to try to devastate our economy, because they would drop the value of the U.S. securities that they hold. But I'm not claiming I have a clear crystal ball. I'm simply claiming.
So it is possible.
It is possible, but there are a number of things we can do, certainly, to reduce the risk from that very substantially.
In your written testimony, you say that USTR is closely examining China's policies restricting exports of raw materials, including REN, continues to press China to remove its export restraints on REN and other raw materials. Can you elaborate on the state of conversations between USTR and PRC? Are we making any headway?
It is my impression that we are making some headway there, but I can't really elaborate. I think it would be appropriate to defer to the USTR on that point for an up-to-date assessment of the state of their interactions.
Okay. Let's do a greater issue, a bigger issue than rare earths. We've been talking about critical materials and rare earth today, but the committee has identified similar failures in other fields. Recent unforeseen shortages of helium-3, you know, the ones that are used for radiation detectors, suggest this is an issue greater than just rare earths. What is the administration doing to characterize and forecast supplies and demands of other materials, such as rare isotopes and strategic minerals, that may be impacted by policies decisions outside of the market?
Well, certainly our focus in the administration and the focus of outside entities such as the National Academy that have looked at these issues is not restricted to rare earths. I commented a while ago that rare earths are judged to be among the most critical, but they're not the only critical elements, and we are looking at the others. The DOD is looking at the others. The DOE is looking at the others. The USTR is looking at the others. The Department of Commerce. We're certainly not confining our attention to rare earths.
Like plutonium-238?
Well, plutonium-238 is, of course, indispensable for radioisotopic thermal power generators, as we use on our Mars missions and other such technologies. Helium-3 is essential. And, yes, we are looking at that. The DOE looks at that closely.
Yeah, just to add, Congressman, in our critical material strategy last year, we looked not just at rare earths, but also at indium, gallium, tellurium, lithium, and cobalt. And then in the request for information that we just submitted to the public, we asked about other materials that might be important of interest. So it's very much an area beyond just the rare earths that we're looking at.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you very much. I know a couple of the witnesses, panel members, need to leave at 4 o'clock, so we want to be conscious of your time. I see that we still, it's a few minutes before 4 o'clock, about 20 minutes till. So my hope is to go through another round of questions. Our committee rules say we are limited to 5 minutes each, but if we can be shorter than that, that would be nice to be able to try and get through all of us. So if that's all right with you all, we'll start going through another round of questions and wrap up at 4 o'clock so one of you can catch a plane and others have other things that you need to get to. Dr. Holdren, one of the provisions of the bill I introduced instructs the Secretary of the Interior and the Secretary of Energy to specify a principal statistical agency. I wonder what your thoughts are on the efficacy and effectiveness of specifying a principal statistical agency.
Well, I guess my response would be I believe we've had a principal statistical agency in the USGS, and where the rubber meets the road would be what additional responsibilities the USGS would have under such a provision and whether they would have the budget to carry out those responsibilities.
I think the challenge is can they identify what the demand is without that? Any thoughts on that or no?
I agree with you.
Okay. Any the other two witnesses have thoughts on that?
As Dr. Holdren said, this would apply to one part of the mineral resources program that provides minerals information, and we would like to better understand what such a designation would truly mean and the ramifications of it, and we'd be happy to answer that more fully for the record.
Okay. We can get you that, and that would be great if you could submit a response to that. That would be very helpful. Quickly, just with another minute or two here, I know one of the challenges is, again, making sure that we've got people who are capable to be doing this work, and certainly we're talking about the resources, but also the intellectual resources are so challenging here. Specifically, we need people, students who have a better grasp of the industrial sciences versus a specific education in rare earths. Wondered if any of you have heard concerns about this and what the government, if it were to spend funds targeting at strengthening industrial science programs, how would it ensure retention of this talent in the U.S. after subsidizing their education?
I'll just start and then turn to Dr. Holdren. I just want to thank you for emphasizing this point, Chairman. It is vitally important. It's vitally important that we have the intellectual capital in this country to invest in this area. I often hear that the expertise follows the research money. And so when the research money is available, then the expertise will be developed. And so it just underscores the importance of maintaining federal support for basic R&D in this area, and in particular in the areas you point to, and in industrial sciences. I mean, industrial manufacturing processes and efficiency are absolutely critical for U.S. competitiveness in the decades ahead. So it's vital that we maintain federal funding support in that area.
I would add, I think it's important, as the formulation of your question suggests, that we look at ways to make it easier for foreign talent that gets educated in this country, particularly getting advanced degrees in science and engineering, that makes it easier for them to stay here. Right now, I think we make it too hard for them to stay here. Some obviously are going to want to go back to their countries. That's not an entirely bad thing, because science and engineering, in some respects, is not a zero-sum game. But we certainly shouldn't be making it hard for foreign nationals who are educated here and want to stay to do so.
To give everyone else a chance, questions as well, I now recognize Ms. Edwards.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just have a couple of quick questions. Dr. Holdren, I just want to point to you. I was looking at the fourth quarter 2010 reports from Molycorp as another suggestion about why China might be rethinking things. In the report, the CEO of Molycorp noted that senior government leaders in China consistently stress China's intent to continue to restrict rare earth exports and the possibility of China becoming a net rare earth importing nation by 2015. CEO Smith also said, and I quote, "These dynamics are why we believe rare earth pricing will remain robust for the foreseeable future. It's also why Molycorp recently committed to expanding its production capacity from 19,050 metric tons per year in 2012 to 40,000 metric tons per year, which is expected to be achieved by 2013. And he says that that will position Molycorp to capture new markets and customers and benefit from continued strong pricing, hence a competitor for China. But I think it's also important and highlights the reason that the United States needs to step up its game, our government needs to step up its game in order to be able to stand up industries that that can compete. And I would also note that Molycorp secured all of its critical government permits that enabled it to proceed with construction of a new rare earth oxide manufacturing facility in Mountain Pass. They broke ground ahead of schedule. They're constructing their new manufacturing facility, and they recommenced mining operations for the first time since 2002. And that is with environmental regulations in place that are actually going to protect the American consumer and those who live in and around Mountain Pass from the dangers that have befallen the Chinese, and the reason that the Chinese, in fact, are having to make these changes and different decisions about what they do with respect to their mining. And I wonder, for USGS, Mr. Doebrich, if you could comment whether from an environmental perspective what sort of concerns we need to be aware of regarding potential environmental contamination as a result of these mining operations and how that impacts what we need to consider in the United States in terms of our own industry with respect to competition with China.
Thank you, Congressman. With regards to rare earths in particular, many of these rare earth minerals contain radioactive components, and so radiation is an environmental issue of concern when developing rare earth resources. So this is an area of research that we're actually getting more involved with to understand what the impact, the natural impact of the known resource in the ground even before resource development, the developing baseline information to understand what the natural baseline geochemical signature is of these resources to help us better understand what the impact of resource development would be for different types of these rare earth deposits. So that's an area of research that we're involved with right now.
In any case, the goal would not be to throw out environmental regulations. That's not what's going to stand up our industry. Thank you, and I'll yield.
Strongly agree.
I now recognize Mr. Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The subject of helium-3 came up, which is also a subject that was that this subcommittee dealt with in the last couple of years. The problem with helium-3 was we didn't know how much of it we had. That was the biggest problem. We didn't have an assessment of what the demand was and what the supply was, and the reason was that helium-3 was produced by the decay of tritium, which was used in nuclear weapons, and how much tritium there was and therefore how much helium-3 there was all classified, so nobody knew how much there was. And we spent billions of dollars developing a technology that depended on a lot of helium-3 and then found out there wasn't that much helium-3. The administration actually appears to have done a pretty good job of dealing with that problem once you realize you had a problem, of kind of assessing what the supply was and figuring out what the demand was and making decisions about priorities. But that appears not to have been unique to helium-3. There are other problems of identifying supply and demand. Dr. Holdren, I think you addressed that at least somewhat in your testimony of identifying the supply and demand. And there is still a problem both in the government, in the private sector, and in the public sector of that information not being available, whether it's needed, treated as a trade secret or confidential for business reasons or whatever else. How much of a problem is that, and how are we going to get at that problem to identify what the demand is and what the supply is?
Well, first of all, Congressman Miller, the first item on my list, consistent with your question of what we need to do, is information.
Right.
We need to do better with information, and there I think, again, the USGS has been a mainstay of our ability to get that information, and in my judgment should continue to be. My understanding is that companies are becoming more forthcoming with the kinds of information we need to make these assessments. I think we're doing better at public-private partnerships in this domain and in some other domains as well. Of course, the problem of classified information that you referred to in the case of tritium is always, in the case of those kinds of materials, going to be something of an obstacle. But it's not true that nobody knew how much tritium we had. It's just that nobody knew in the public domain how much we had. And there was probably a lack for a time of connecting the dots, as they say, among the different people who had the requisite information. But I do believe we're doing better going forward. We have an approach to open government and transparency in this administration that is yielding, I think, real benefits in terms not only of the kinds of data and databases that the government is making available, but also in terms of an increasing a tendency toward transparency in business.
Okay. Anyone else?
Thank you. If I might add, this is a topic that I hear about from businesses when I talk about this issue with them, and they say that government really has an important role to play in collecting the information, and we were encouraged at the U.S. Department of Energy to inquire about this in the last request for information that we put out, and we did so, and among other things, we said that we would keep information proprietary and collect it on that basis if businesses wanted us to do that. So we've collected proprietary information, looking at ways in which we might be able to share it while protecting the confidential nature of it by aggregation or other types of tools. But I hear about this all the time from the industry as an important area. I'd note, too, that on our Energy Information Agency, the EIA, which is our statistical agency, had plans to scale up its work in this area, but as a result of the latest round of budget pressures and cuts, is unable to pursue its additional work in this area, which I think is unfortunate. But this is an area that, no question, that we hear about all the time in the Energy Department.
Okay. Just for purposes of clarifying something, which I was reasonably clear already, but when you say flooding the market, you really mean that the Chinese are selling rare earths below cost to drive out competitors. It's what is called the antitrust laws, predatory pricing, so that other suppliers will not compete because they have a dominant position in the market and they've got a government behind them funding it all. Is that generally what you mean when you say flooding the market?
Well, Congressman, I didn't use the term flooding the market. Your colleagues used it, but I think what they have in mind is not what the Chinese are doing now. The Chinese are I believe, not losing money under current pricing. But the concern is that as we start to develop more effective competition with the Chinese at current prices, the concern is they could undercut those,
right,
as happened some decades ago in the international oil market, where we developed some expensive alternatives to conventional oil, and OPEC cut its prices to undercut those technologies. That that history causes people to worry about that possibility. And as I've said before, it is a possibility. I don't have a crystal ball clear enough to rule it out, but I think our strategy needs to be to be prepared for a wide variety of possible scenarios. And the way you get prepared for that, again, is better information, it's diversification, it's recycling, it's research.
Okay. Thank you.
I want to thank the witnesses for their valuable testimony and for the members for their questions. The members of the subcommittee may have additional questions for the witnesses, and we will ask you to respond to those in writing, if that's all right. The record will remain open for 2 weeks for additional comments from members. The witnesses are excused, and the hearing is now adjourned.
Got them in on time.
Thank you.
Thank you, too.
Good afternoon.